powerful and present with him. Holy Spirit, our helper. Holy Spirit, our teacher. Holy Spirit, our strength. Holy Spirit, our comfort. Overshadow us with your divine presence.
Amen.
Give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of your word. Cause your name alone to be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Are you happy to be in God's presence?
Yes, sir.
Do we have our material?
Yes, sir.
We are going to spend some time in this material, ladies and gentlemen. So we started with the fact that we have to be born again. That was the foundation. Then holiness. We just concluded faithfulness. Faithfulness and commitment, they are so close. They are like brothers and sisters. They are like siblings. The Lord will give us understanding this morning in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians 15:57. Let's encourage ourselves. It has to do with faithfulness, it has to do with diligence, it has to do with commitment, it has to do with dedication, it has to do with everything that has to do with our Christian work as leaders in the church, as ministers of God, as servants of God. 1 Corinthians 15:57. Can we read it together? 1, 2, 3. For if, what is this? 57, not 27. 5, 7, and 5, 8. If you can display it together, that would be great. 5, 7, and 5, 8. Please, the engineer, I want you to look into the reason why this thing is speaking. There's a reason. There must be a reason why it's not. Can we read together? I want to read. But thanks be to God, who give us what? The victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be what?
Steadfast.
Be unmovable. Always abounding in the word of the Lord. Why? Knowing that your labor is not in the vain in the Lord. Very, very important scripture. If you have a Bible, you should mark it and put a star on it. That's why I was talking about it and things of God. I'll do a whole round about it. But thanks be to God who did us what? Always. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, when you see therefore, it's because of the preceding. Because of the preceding, because we always have victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, my beloved brothers and sisters, be what? Irrespective of what is going on. Because the pastor, your brothers and sisters, we are going to offend one another. It's not about the offense, it's about the response to the offense. What? Immovable. A lot of people have been moved away from the plan and purpose of God. Always. Always. It's not today, you don't do it tomorrow. That is the problem in the church. Lack of diligence. Lack of consistency. My teacher said something I will never forget. He said successful people in the kingdom, they do always what all successful people does once in a while. Even not in the kingdom alone. Successful people in life, they do on consistent basis what all successful people does once in a while. Always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing, having the understanding that your labor is not in vain. God is a rewarder of those that diligently, in all labor, there is always profit. So coming to church in this place, we are not serving the brother Harrison or the wife. It is a service unto God. Even in your work, even what you do at home, I told him there is no difference as a born again Christian between sacred and secular. The Bible says, whatever your hand tries to do, do it with the whole of your mind. There's a reward for everything. I thank you very much. I appreciate God for your life. Coming to church early like this, it's awesome. Some people have been here since 8 o'clock by 3 o'clock. We thank God for everybody's participation. But this is not to encourage us. No matter the effort we are putting to this work, it is never in vain. God is going to reward us abundantly in Jesus' name. We are going to testify to the goodness of the Lord. Because God is faithful. Commitment. We're number four. It's all about commitment. Commitment is the key to excellence. Don't suddenly achieve excellence. No. For any meaningful achievement in any endeavor, commitment is a prerequisite. Without it, nothing can be accomplished until we workers really got committed to God and to the establishment of his kingdom. Nothing can be achieved. It's not by mouth. Look at this. I put a star in this one. Look at it. To be successful in any field, it is what? Costly. There's a price to pay. But the man who will pay the price can have it. Anything in life, you have to pay for it. Those who have ever accomplished anything in this life were what? Committed. There's a price to pay. And one thing is this. It is good to say it, but that commitment of faithfulness is going to be tested. That is what we are going to see this morning as we continue to grow. It is very, very good to say it. A lot of us can say it, we can sing it. But God is going to test that faithfulness. He's going to test that commitment. The price for success is costly, but the reward is what? Astonishing. Therefore, success requires what? Hard work, diligence, devotion, dedication. They are all together. If our commitment level is low, then our success level will be what? If our commitment level is high, then our success level will be what? God is faithful. Sow nothing, reap nothing. We are not talking about money now. Anytime we talk about sowing, people think it's about money. Hello? Commitment consists of being sold out to God unflinchingly, going the extra mile. If you are sleeping, I will ask you to stand up. Because you are not supposed to be sleeping in this kind of environment. It does not matter what. Hello? I'll call your name. So if you are sleeping, it's better to stand up yourself. Complete, permanent, and selfless dedication are requirements in the kingdom. Growth is strangulated when commitment is what? Lacking. Being indifferent, half-hearted, and lukewarm will only bring what? Death
and decay.
One person with commitment, persistence, and endurance will accomplish much more than 1,000 people with what? Mere interest. God rewards commitment. Look at another one. These are powerful words. Don't just really think about all this thing. Your place of commitment is where God reveals himself to you. If you are totally committed to God, he will touch you and he will begin to make an extraordinary impact on the world. God sees our heart. If you are genuinely committed to God, God will begin to use you. God will begin to open treasures unto you. God will begin to use you to do exceedingly abundantly, more than what you can even think about or imagine. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard what God has put in his store. For those that love him, not the love of the man, but he has revealed them. Then we go to his case study. Apostle Peter. I told you, commitment will be tested. Peter struggled a lot, but a change came to his life after the restoration. Peter, you can put your name there. Do you really love me? What you are doing right now? He said, you know, sir, that I love you. He said, oh God, keep my love. He denied Christ 3 times. He restored him 3 times. But somebody read John This is what I want us to see. John 21, 18 to 19. Can you display John? Look at it. After the struggle, after the restoration, Christ told him this thing. I want us to read it and you are going to see.
Most assuredly,
most assuredly,
I say to you,
I say unto you,
when you were younger,
when you are younger,
you guided yourself,
you guided yourself,
and walked where you wish,
and walked where to where you want to.
But when you are old,
but when you are old,
you will stretch out your hands,
you will stretch out your hand,
and another will guide you.
Another one will guide you. Don't interpret it by your mind. The interpretation is going to come in the next verse. What is the interpretation? Next verse.
This is spoke. This is spoke.
This is spoke.
Signifying by what?
Signifying by what manner of death Peter is going to die.
He will glorify God.
That he will bring glory to the name of God.
And when he has spoken this,
and when he has spoken this,
he said to him,
he said to him,
follow me.
Follow me. Now that you have been restored, Peter, I'm going to tell you, you are going to die. Your commitment to me is that this commitment is going to lead you to death. Follow me. Since that time, Peter never went back. He never was. And according to history, Peter was crucified. And when he was supposed to be crucified, he said, sir, man, I don't want to die like Christ died. Turn me upside down. Commitment. And that was why God is able to use him to write hospital. Second Peter, to comfort you, to console us. The Lord gave us understanding in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Peter was an ordinary fisherman. But because of his commitment to God, he was mightily used of God. And two books were written by him. Peter's shadow, in the sea. And by the hands of the apostle were many signs and wonders brought upon the people. And they were all with one accord in Solomon's court. And of the rest thought, no man joined himself to them, that the people magnified them. And believers are the more added to the church, multitudes, both men and women, insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter by might overshadow some of them. Yes, there also a multitude of out of the city, round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were what? Beds with unclean spirit, and they were ill, every one of them. God using Peter. My prayer this morning is God will use you and I in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That is what is being demonstrated in the life of Pastor Nebuchadnezzar today. If it can happen to my life and your life, if we are really committed to God, there's a price to pay. Look at the next thing. This is what I want to focus on today. The life God has given each of us is for what?
A purpose.
Our life is a loan. Look at the next one. So we must do our best for our maker and what? Creator. As we renew our commitment to him, we must be prepared to offer our what? Isaac. I love that. Or break the alabaster box if there's a need for it. In this last days, there is a need for such a depth of commitment. Pastor Adeboye give a testimony. Nothing happened in life by accident. I told us in one of the wedding services, the Lord has made us to be a royal priesthood. And one of the primary roles of a priesthood is what? Give it to me. The primary role of a priest is what? Sacrifice. And you are not in the meeting alone. Were you on wedding service? You are not there. The primary duty of a priest is to sacrifice. Our model of Jesus was the greatest priest ever. He was the high priest of our confession. He sacrificed his own life as an example. So you and I, we are supposed to also follow what? The same example. That's what Romans 12 verse 1. We are supposed to sacrifice our life. And I told you, our commitment, they are going to be what? Tested. If indeed we are really committed. So we talk about what? Isaac. You know the story of Isaac?
Yes, sir.
Genesis 22. Abraham was sleeping. One day he heard the voice of God. Abraham, Abraham, the test is coming. sacrificed unto me the only Son, the one that you love. Isaac was there. Who's the other son?
Ishmael.
So the emphasis is talking, it's not Ishmael. The one, your covenant son. The one that you love, take him to Mount Ararat as an Oreah and sacrifice to me. The test of commitment. What did Abraham do? He obeyed. He didn't even tell the wife. He didn't bind the devil. The devil, I bind you. This is the devil. Genesis 22. I'm not going to read you all. I tell you, until we have got to the realm of sacrificing to God, that is where we are going to see. He said, well, if you have done what you have not done before, you need to see what you have never seen before. That is why a lot of people in the kingdom, they are just marking time. By the grace of God, on this altar, we are not going to be we are not going to do anything to manipulate anybody to be. The teaching of giving, they are going to be coming, but there is not going to be any manipulation. The truth of the word of God are going to be spoken. It is left for you and I to decide. Genesis 22. Genesis, okay. Even before this, look at the case. Let me read Genesis 8, 20 to 22. The covenant of giving and receiving was established because of the sacrifice of Noah after the flood. Genesis 8, 20 to 22. Look at that.
Then Noah built an ark.
He built an ark
for the Lord.
To the Lord.
And took
the Lord smelled aroma. His meat service for God.
Then the Lord said to him in his heart.
He said in his heart.
I will never again curse the ground.
I will never again curse the ground.
For the man said.
For the man said.
Although the imagination of man's heart is evil.
You see.
From his youth.
Okay.
Now will I again destroy every living thing as I have done.
Okay. Look at the covenant of giving and receiving.
Why the hedge remains.
Why the hedge remains.
Seed times and harvest.
Seed time and harvest.
Cold and heat.
Cold and heat.
Winter and summer.
Summer and summer.
And day and night.
Day and night. Just because of the sacrifice of the man. God told him, as you are going to this chief, carry only male and female. And after the victory, all he did do is sacrifice the best. And because of this, the covenant was established. Read Psalm 50 verse 5. Psalm 50 verse 5. Psalm 50 verse 5. Want to read? Gather my saints together to me. Those who have made a covenant with me by what?
By sacrifice.
Sacrifice becomes what? A covenant that provoke divine intervention. It's not by mouth. God wants to see the sincerity of our commitment. Okay, Genesis 22, verse 2. Let's read 1 and 2. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. God tested Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thy only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get him into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I tell thee. Abraham rose up early in the morning. He continued. Look at verse 8. Look at verse. Let's go to. Okay, let's read 8. And Abraham, my son, God, the son now has the father. Let's read 7. Isaac spake unto him, Abraham, his father, and said, my father, he said, here am I, my son. And he said, behold the fire and the wood. But where is the lamb for a burnt offering? 8. And Abraham said to him, my son, God will what? Provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. He actually wanted to kill this boy. Verse 9. And they came to the place which God had told of him. And Abraham built an altar. Look at it. He's talking about, he's referencing the case of Noah now. He also did what? An altar. And laid the wood in order. And bound Isaac his son. And laid him on the altar upon the wood. 10. And Abraham stretched forth his hand. And took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven. This is divine intervention. And said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here am I. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know. I know that thou what? Fear me. Your fear of God is going to be tested. It's not by now. Your love for God will be tested. Seeing thou hast not withheld thy only son from me. Okay, book of 15, look at it. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself I have sworn, said the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thy only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars in the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the sea, and thy seed shall possess the gates of their enemy. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Pastor Bigwe gave a testimony in the early process of the church. Pastor Ade Patayomi came to the assembly just like this. He said, my children, there's a need in the church. As leaders of the church, please go home and close your account. We are not going to say that, so that I don't think that we're going to say that to Jesus. Hello? Go and close your account and bring whatever is there. The Lord has a budget in. They left. The following Sunday, they came. Based on what I told you on Sunday, if you have closed your account, and even it could be the wisdom of God, just to know who the leader of this church is going to be. God is a wise God.
Yes.
And how many of you have done what I asked to do? Nobody stood up. Only Pastor Bimini and the wife. It does not matter the amount in their account. They said with what they have. They said they were surprised that you are the only one. Nothing happened by accident. God, my Lord, in this dispensation, God is not telling you to give your only son or daughter. But I'm not God has been speaking to you in this assembly. Hello. Buy a bus for this church. Because of this community service. You see a bus? Me buy a bus. How much is a bus? 10,000? I bind you, devil. I destroy your people works. The enemy can never tell you to buy a bus.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Have you not heard about the centurion man? Hello? The Bible says he single-handedly built a what? A synagogue. Apart from paying his hand. Sacrificial giving. Provoke. And you know what happened to him? Finding favor. One of the things that I struggled with a lot of time is because of all this grace teaching, because I told you sometimes I follow this teaching. It's a lot of confusion that favor is unmerited assets. So some really good is right. So at times when I read my Bible and I see all these things, I begin to wonder. It's a contradiction. I tell you, a lot of favor, they are provoked because of what you and I did. Look at it. He said, because of this thing you have done, in blessing, I will bless you. Provoking supernatural intervention. As I said, we are going to bring the truth on this altar. We are not going to bring any man of God to come and manipulate anything. It's not in this church that somebody will be coming. If you are there, you give 1,000. If you are there, give 2,000. No. 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 We can do nothing against the truth. The total counsel of God is going to be preached. The decision is in your hand, in my hand. Have you not heard about the story of Solomon? The Bible said Solomon loved the law. And what he gave a thousand. David single-handedly provided for the building of the temple. I can't even get to what I want to do this morning. Wonderful story. The story of the Abel. Let's read it. Let's read it conclude. Isaac break what? And break the alabaster. So the story is in Mark. Maybe you can capture it again. I don't want to. Let's try. Mark 14, 1 to 9. We cannot finish. I want us to read it. Mark 14, 1 to 9. After 2 days, it was the Passover and the feast of the unleavened bread. And the chief priest, by the grace of God, for the sake of those that are just coming in, we are dealing with commitment. We have been treating. Where are the material? Will you please give to them some copies? The code of conduct for leaders in the church. We started with every leader, every member of the team. We have to be born again. We must be born again. Then the second thing that is of importance is holy living. Holiness is a must. We have dealt with that. We have done faithfulness. And for the last 1 week, we have been dealing with commitment. And the emphasis this morning is that our faithfulness, our pronouncement of commitment to God, it has to be tested. Because the Bible says, disciples, they love me with the whole of our mouth. But what? Their heart is far. That can never be our portion in Jesus' name. So God tested Abraham. And no, the love of Abraham, the commitment of Abraham to me is genuine. Then look at another woman. Look at another woman. And the chief priest, brothers, what is going on? After 2 days, for the Passover and the feast of the unleavened bread, and the chief priest and the scribes sought out them and take him by trickery and put him to death too. The time of his death was here. And they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar of the people, never. And being in Bethany at the house of what? Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came having what? An alabaster flask of very costly on her hand, oil or spikenard. Then she broke the flask and poured it on his head. Who is this woman? This woman is, there are two stories. This woman, according to the book of John 12, is Mary. Notice Mary was the one that is always sitting at the feet of Jesus. And Christ told, when his sister was complaining, he said, Martha, Martha, thou art cumbered and complaining about many things. One thing is needful, and this Mary has chosen it, which cannot be denied from him. So, because of the inspiration Mary has been getting sitting down at the feet of Jesus, emphasizing the word of God, she was able to know that the time of the death of Christ was here. And she brought, let's look at something. Let's look at something. Four. But there were some who were what? Indignant among themselves. Our time is passing. And said, why this fragrant oil wasted? There is nothing you give unto crack that is wasted. Okay, give me a minute more. Verse 4, I just want to. For it might have been sold for more than what? 300 denarii. Okay, we have interest in this assembly. Help me know the equivalent of 300 denarii in this time as we are going to close. We'll continue from here next one. I want you to do it yourself. 300 denarii. Type it to your computer and your Google. What is the equivalent of 300 denarii in this present time? A 104 million, I didn't want to say it, but I want it to come from you. 4 million, 79,000, and it's an equivalent of a year salary. Mary was able to know the works of Christ. Let's just finish. We draw inspiration, let's see. And the priestesses are sharply, never. But Jesus said, let her what? Alone. Why do you trouble her? She she has done a good work for you. Never. For you have it poor with you always. And whenever you eat, you may look the them good. But me, you do not have always. Seven. She has done what she was. She could do. She has done what she could do according to her capacity. She has become the woman to anoint my body for burial. Next verse, as we close, we continue next week. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as what? That is not what we are saying today. Let us pray. We draw inspiration from there, from mercy. Commitment is not by mouth, ladies and gentlemen. Commitment is not by mouth. It's not by mouth. Our commitment, our faithfulness has to be tested. Has to be tested. And God is going to do it in diverse ways. Let's pray this morning and ask for the help of the Holy Spirit. To be able to know what we do to open up our destiny. A lot of people today complain, oh, Pastor Adeboye is riding aircraft. Pastor who? Pastor Wina? Pastor Oyedepo is doing this. If you know the price they are paying, you will not be saying like that. And it is your responsibility to also keep. If you do what they have done, you begin to see what they have seen. Father, we thank you this morning. We appreciate you because you said we can know the truth. The truth will set us free. We can do nothing against the truth. But for the truth, continue to reveal your truth to us in this assembly. We are not here to manipulate anybody. But we are going to bring the total counsel of God so that you and I will need to make the decision according to the will of God. Help us, Holy Spirit. As we continue this service, continue with us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Sabbath school time. Father, we thank you. We honor you for the word. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. Holy Spirit, we pray that you minister more, even unto your Son that you have used to bless our lives in Jesus' name. More grace, more anointing in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we have heard your word. Help us to be the doer in Jesus' name. We're also going to the study of your word today. Holy Spirit, minister to us expressly. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord. By the special grace of God this morning, we are going to review. There are a lot of lessons that we've gone through, and probably we have questions. And also at the end of it, we're going to discuss how we can improve the Sunday school. We need suggestions, we need contribution on what we can do. The Lord will help us in Jesus' mighty name. So is there anything we have in mind concerning all the teachings, different things we've been taught? We are starting from lesson 27. Which says anger. Do we have any question concerning anger? We said it does so much with it. We discussed that anger is an outburst, our expression of carnality. That's the way our book expression of carnality. That is the works of flesh. Is a window or a door to demon entrance, a foothold, a landing pad for demons, is a tool of destruction. Devil uses it against the people of God, against believer, anger, unforgiveness. It's supposed not to be. Praise the Lord. And we saw the example of so many people that they are angry in the Bible. Cain, Moses, Balaam, Uzziah, King Ahasuerus, concerning Vashti, who refused to come to his presence. We saw Haman, who says, oh no, Mordecai is not going to rule. We saw Absalom, first son of David, how he killed his half-brother because that one slept with her own sister. And we saw that the end of it it was a destruction, anger. So that is what anger can do. Praise the Lord. And we'll also see that one of the product of anger is revenge. You want to say, oh, does that mean to be angry is a sin? The Bible says you can be angry and sin not. Praise the Lord. So if you are angry, see, look at the product that anger is bringing. Is it peace? Is it life? There are some when they are angry, they will tell you, let me tell you, I will just do it to the end. Anger, devilish anger, talks about revenge. I'm going to deal with him. I'm going to deal with her. The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. So how do we have remedy? Give yourself continually to fasting, prayer, and the word of God. That is what can help us. Continually, because when you are waiting, you don't want anything to disturb your prayers. Even if you're supposed to talk, but for the fact that you are waiting, you just feel, let me just overlook it. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Lesson 28 talks about keeping your joy. How do we keep our joy? Philippians 4:14 says, rejoice in the Lord always, and I say again, rejoice. So joy is the fruit of the Spirit. Joy is different from happiness. Happiness, when you are happy, is just concerning what is happening around you. But joy comes from above. Joy comes from the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. That is the difference between. And you know, we have talked about joy killers. Joy killers. Talks about worry, jealousy, when you think that what belongs to somebody else should belong to you. That is jealousy and envy. Then, also joy stealer also talks about anger, discontentment. When you don't really appreciate what you have, you appreciate what other people has. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. 29, when the wine finished, it talks about different ways that wine can finish physical life, spiritual life, mental or emotional life. Talks about physical, talks about health, career, marriages, or personal, interpersonal relationship. Talks about our relationship with others. So when can finish? And also spiritual life, when you are praying, the way you're supposed to pray, you are not praying like that. Something is wrong. When the flame is going down, that means the wine is about to finish. The mental or emotional life, absence of love, peace between us and God, or between human beings, is an indication that wine has finished or is finishing. Praise the Lord. Then causes of dry wine, underestimation, sabotage, disobedience, generational causes or inflicted causes. All these things, the carefree attitude can make a wine to finish. Praise the Lord. That is when some things you're supposed to do, you don't do them. And this life is not like, it's not a magic that things can happen. Just like we have had about commitment. So when we are not committed to what we're supposed to, then wine can go down. Then consequences of it, when it's going down, you didn't do anything about it, it causes shame, reproach, conflict, disorganized home, lack of peace, loss of love, affliction, or demonic attack. Then the result might be death. That will not be our testimony in Jesus' name. So how do we rescue ourselves even from wine being finished? Number one is a genuine repentance. When we genuinely repented of different lives we are living, then second one, we ask for God. We invite Christ to take over. Christ taking over, then we continue. Without continuation, there's no way the wine can increase. We need to continue. It's not something we do today that goes good tomorrow. So that's the rescue mission. for the wine to come. Praise the Lord. I pray that the level of wine in our lives, ritually, physically, materially, financially, will be increased in Jesus' name. When we look at our finances, the wine is going down. Check your giving to God or check your giving to other people. People around us, are we blessing to them? Or because at times when we are not paying our tithes, different things might come up that you will even pay more of your tithes than just paying to God. Praise the Lord. It happens. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Lesson 30, Rahab and the spies. Rahab was a chief harlot, not ordinary harlot. She was a chief harlot. What does that lesson teach us? The teachings taught us that there is nobody that God cannot use. And we should not underestimate anyone. Well, and even all these are our children, there are some things they know that we do not know. We should be humble enough to learn from them. Praise the Lord. We should be humble enough to learn from one another. Who could believe that Rahab will have so much faith? When people that the Israelites themselves, the 10 that brought evil reports, did not have the kind of faith that that woman had. Because if they do, they wouldn't have brought that report. Come and see this woman that people thought she was an unbeliever. She believed, she said, I know, I've heard what your God is doing. And people that have that God did not believe. Praise the Lord. So God is teaching us that he can use anybody. And also, God is making us to realize that there is no sinner that cannot be saved. No matter how we have gone in life, God can still accept us back. Praise the Lord. Talks about also the wisdom of God, that God can use anything. That is why we should not be full of ourselves. God can use anything. Somebody that you don't even think that God can use. You just unpick the person. You now be thinking, God will not replace us in Jesus' name. So our God is full of wisdom. There's no one he cannot use. Praise the Lord. Look at Naaman. Naaman, thank God, even despite the position, he listened to that to the wife. When the woman came to him that, see what my maid said. That is it not for you to just go there and watch for 7 days and see what is going to happen? There are some people that cannot even take advice. They look down at the people that are talking that, you want to give me advice? You don't even have what I have. Praise the Lord. The Lord have mercy on us in Jesus' name. Lesson 31 talks about divine favor. Divine favor is God's good face upon ones, which makes the difference between outstanding success and ordinary success. So this is when God prefers you or me more than others. If you are telling me that there is no divine favor, there is one. Praise the Lord. And what are the things? How can we get it? You can pray for it. It can be purchased by obedience. When you obey God, divine favor can come. We can pray for it. Then it can come when God wants to keep his covenant. All the covenant, there are some covenant that the Lord showed, we usually pray for Abrahamic covenant. Abrahamic covenant is as a result of what somebody did. Praise God. So, divine favor can come through covenant. Somebody obeyed God. And the Bible says it was imputed for him for righteousness. And what Christ did today is what brought us into his kingdom so that we can have favor with God. Praise the Lord. So somebody paid the price. Christ paid that price. And that was what gave us access to his kingdom. Praise the Lord. And also, this divine favor brings security. Then it talks about health care. That is the maintenance or improvement of health via prevention, diagnosis, treatment of disease, illness, injury, other physical or mental impairment. So what is this topic taught us? That
We shouldn't say, oh, we are not going to take care of ourselves. We need to take care of ourselves medically. And this topic taught us that it is not a sin for you and I to seek for medical help. Praise the Lord. That doesn't mean we should put God aside. It's God that makes medical things to work. If God, you know, there are some people when they take medication, it doesn't work for them. And there are some that if you are going to the hospital, you say, God, just have your way. Use those people there for me. You have put God ahead of you. And if you put God ahead, He will not disappoint. Praise the Lord. We've seen so many specialists that even though they are specialists, they make mistakes on people. And before you know it, that was the end of their lives. So that is why in everything we do, we need God. Praise the Lord. So in everything we do, we need God. Praise the Lord. So how do we improve or prevent health problem, our eating habits? Eating, sleeping well, drinking enough water, doing regular exercises, yearly physical, antenatal immunization for children. Praise the Lord. Welcome, my ladies. How are you? You are welcome. Praise the Lord. So above all, we should remember our ultimate faith and trust should be in God, not in medical processes. It is God that can make things work. Praise the Lord. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Then we also talked about longevity. It says, the Bible says in Proverbs 9:11, it says, for by me thy days shall be multiplied and the years of thy life shall be increased. So God is interested in our longevity, but God cannot force it on us. At times our confession might bring something different. Praise the Lord. We need to be very careful. If you go into the presence of God, the Bible says the one who speaks is a spirit and is a life. And the Bible says the death and life are in the power of tongue. They that love it, they will eat the fruit thereof. One man of God used to say, our father used to say, he said, I will live the rest of my life in heaven. So why am I in the hurry to go? Praise the Lord. So why are we in a hurry to go to heaven? Since we know that is where we are going to stay for life. Praise God. So God honors what we want. He honors our will. So that is why we shouldn't use our mouth to say negative things. Oh, I have finished my work. You are the one that said it. So if the enemy now mount upon that word and begin to walk, so is that the devil's attack? No, it is the word. Praise the Lord. So we are not ready. We still have so many to do for God in Jesus' name. So we also talks about different things that can help us, that can help longevity. He talks about the fear of God, positive confession. Fasting can boost our health and prolong life. It is not every time we should be eating and eating 24/7. This body needs rest. And by the time we are trying to fast, there are a lot of dirty things in the body that will be flushed out. Praise the Lord. So we should not be eating 365 days. Praise the Lord. Then also talks about honoring our parents, whether spiritual or biological. They are blessing in keeping all this. Even if your parents are unbeliever, still honor the word of God in their life. Because God will not bend his rule for anybody, whether they are bad. We still need to do what we're supposed to do as children. Praise the Lord. The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. Example of Abraham, 170, he died 175 years, Moses 120, Enoch 365, Sarah 127, Noah 950. So living is good, but the quality of it is very important. Living long is good, but the quality of it is very important. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Also, we talked about mental health, what every Christian should do, Though the Bible says, I wish you above all things that thou may prosper and be in good health as your soul prospereth. It is the will of God that we should live in good health. Praise the Lord. But at the same time, when different things come up, we need to deal with it. We need to allow God to work in us and also seek medical help. He talks about different types, depression, anxiety, or alcoholism, substance abuse, or addiction, even the behavior. Praise the Lord. Then also rest and relaxation. This one, the Bible says, when God created heaven and earth, he rested. So if we are now walking and walking without rest, then it is no longer God. Praise the Lord. There are some things we are attached to devil that are not devil. When our body needs rest, let us rest. Because if we don't take that rest, that body will take it one day. And that is when you see people getting sick. That will not be a testimony in Jesus' mighty name. Also, we talked about divine health. Divine health, the Bible says, he sent forth his words and he healed them. These are the plan and purpose of God, even for our lives, that we should be in good health. So divine healing is subject to condition of absolute obedience to God's command. So when we are living in obedience to God, definitely there's no way we'll not experience divine health. Praise the Lord. But it takes commitment. Praise God. You cannot just wake up one day, I'm not going to take this, I'm not going to take that. No. It depends on your relationship with God. The Lord will help us in Jesus' mighty name. Also, we talked to you, I know that one will be fresh in our memory. And may marital delay. What we can do, then child adoption, how we can do everything to the glory of his name. So I want to give time for questions, and all the teachers, we should be ready to answer, to give answers to all the questions, if probably we have any. Praise the Lord. Any question concerning all the topics or any contribution? Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to start with praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So with anger. The Bible says that anger dwells in the bosom of fools. And the devil has been using anger to rob us, the children of God. Because when we are angry, we tend not to be able to do what we are intended to do, or what we are supposed to do. And that's what the devil likes, the enemy likes. And anger, I have come to realize that anger is a delay of progress. Because you may be angry with that your destiny helper, and you don't know it. The enemy may know. The enemy knows that this place, I'm using an example like that, this place that one is, you're going to make progress in that place. You're going to do something great. Those are our pastors, we have been talking about commitment. Nothing comes easy. There must be temptation. So because the enemy knows that, there's going to be a lot of trouble. People will offend you. People will say things they are not supposed to say. Things will be in the wrong place. You just continue to be angry. Whereas, because of your anger, people are seeing that anger there. But eventually, destiny help out. Somebody that is supposed to help you is there. Say, this person is an angry person. Don't go and talk to him or her. So let's be very careful with the things of anger. We know how anger made David strip Mephibosheth from his inheritance without confirming from Mephibosheth. By the time Mephibosheth met David, David said, and explained to David what happened, how Ziba tricked him. But David has already given his word. David has already given his word concerning the inheritance. So let's be very careful, prayerful, that anger will not make us lose the things that are more important to us. And when it comes to the children too, with things of anger, and with things of being angry, let's be very careful also, even with children. Children also, they can do things that are not coming. They want to do things that God doesn't approve of. Let's be very careful. That's the devil trying to block us so that we will not be able to pray for them as we should. But the Lord will help us.
Amen.
He says anger dwells. He did not say we should not be angry. He said, do not allow the sun go down on your anger. And when he says anger dwells, that means he resides inside of you. You should not reside inside of you. It's living there. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Any other contribution? Any other contribution? Yes, sir.
Yeah, so mine is on adoption and fostering, the topic we talked about. It would have been helpful maybe after the class if they had provided maybe where you can, how, or I don't know, maybe link to how you can adopt or where you can adopt, you know. It would have been, in case people are interested in adopting. So it would have been helpful, maybe it's okay, you will take us go. Something, this is the science, if you are interested in adopting.
Praise the Lord. So silent.
Concerning that, we can provide a link for you. I didn't mean that.
People will want it like that because we feel like this is a generation of the internet, everybody can just Google something, but we can easily provide an example. Praise the Lord. I want to talk again about keeping your joy. It is very interesting how the writer of this devotion looked at it, and the topic in 29, 28, 7 was anger, and the second one, 28, was keeping your joy. Keeping your joy, very interesting topic, related to the topic that we had this morning in our home for our morning devotion. Keeping your joy. And if you look at the memory verse, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. It's a command. Rejoice in the Lord. If you know you have the Lord, do not allow anger strip you of your joy. Do not allow anger. I tell my children every time, nobody can make you angry. It is you. Nobody can make you lose your cool or lose your joy. It is you. It depends on you. And it depends on me to lose my cool, to lose my joy. When we try as much as it lies in us, knowing what losing our joy will bring. Apart from the spiritual implication, what about the physical implication concerning our health? Our health, when we are always upset, always angry, our heart is telling. Our immune system is also telling. So let's as Christians, I will not say as Christians, because everybody is a Christian. As children of the Most High Lord, let us try as much as it lies in us to rejoice at all times. Situations will come. Just like what my daughter was saying this morning, doesn't mean because you're Christian and there will not be There will not be ups and downs. God never promised us a smooth ride. There will be roller coasters along the way. And but since we already know that, just like Jesus Christ in the book of Matthew 5, when he was telling the people, his disciples and others that were listening, that there will be persecution. So our minds are already prepared. Like the pastor also said this morning, it's easier said than done. Our minds are already prepared. So our minds should already be prepared for problems that will come. But knowing this, that God will not defame his name. His name will not be dragged to mud in our lives.
Amen.
So praise the Lord.
Amen.
Let us remember that verse, Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord. Always, again, and I say rejoice. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
All I want to chip in concerning that is so many times we see somebody who offends us, we don't see somebody we have offended. And also, as believers, we need to tune to the Spirit of God most of the time. When you offend somebody, when you have that spirit inside of you to know that you have offended somebody. The Bible says offense will come. But who is he through which the offense comes? Praise the Lord. So we should not be a stumbling block to somebody. Is it the way we talk? Is it our words? So many of us, we don't know the gravity of words. We just use it carelessly. And you have because of it, somebody's head is hurting. And you don't even know. Praise the Lord. We should be sensitive to the Spirit of God. So many times when something happens, you should have a check in your spirit. Or even if your husband is angry, you should be able to know that your husband is angry or your wife is angry. Praise the Lord. It is lack of insensitivity or carelessness that makes us not to know that our spouse is not happy with us. And those are the little ways that devil comes in. Even as parents, we may offend our children. We shouldn't be too big to tell them that we are sorry. Praise the Lord. That is the truth. At times, we might have accused them wrongly. Praise the Lord. Probably at their back, they've already gotten a slap. We now realize that, and this thing is not like that. You know, you yourself will feel bad. You call them and say, I'm sorry, it has happened. I'm talking with experience. Praise the Lord. So all those things, we need to be careful about it. So that the devil will not have ways in our lives, in our home, and in our marriages. Because there is no way you are angry against one another that the enemy does not know. It's a spirit he knows. And by the time all those things happen, you will not be able to pray together. He has already won. That is 1-0. No communication. That is another one. Or if your spouse asks you something, you say, yes, no. You should know that something is wrong. And if you are really children of God, we should be able to know that something is wrong. Sensitive to our environment, the Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
No, any other contribution before we round up? I believe that with this review, we've been blessed and the grace to be the doer that the Lord will grant unto us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let us always listen to the Spirit of God. Because when at times when somebody offended you, Holy Spirit will say, keep quiet. You say, no, let me give it to him. Holy Spirit will say, don't talk now. Say, no. If I did not say anything, you will think I'm stupid. Praise the Lord. Every one of us, we have conscience. Praise the Lord. And the more we give ourselves to the Holy Spirit, I want to tell you, he will be directing us. But when we don't listen, we'll just keep quiet and be watching. Until that person gets into a ditch. That will not be our testimony in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. We honor you this morning. We give you all the glory for this review. We exalt your name and we pray that you give us the grace to be the doer of your word in Jesus' name. And your word that we have had, Holy Spirit, on that glorious day, let us all be justified and not condemned in the name of Jesus Christ.
Cover the rest of the service with the blood of Jesus. Glorify yourself in our midst, O Lord. Thank you, King of glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Shall we please be on our feet? It is time to worship God. Let's think of all the good things He has done for us and how we're here today, this morning. And it's only by His grace. He's been faithful to us. He's been faithful to us. Lord, we worship You. We give You all the glory and the honor. Thank You, Jesus, for Your goodness. Thank You, Jesus, for Your faithfulness.
Thank You, Lord.
Thank You, Jesus, for Your love. You alone are worthy of our praise, God. We
worship You.
We give You all the glory and all the honor. You're so faithful to us, even when we don't deserve it. Lord, whatever that is